Welcome back to another flipped lesson today with Miss Dooley for all you pre-AP chem nerds out there. Hopefully you had a great experience today on the test, and we are going to keep rocking and rolling. Good news about this video is you can always go back and reference. If we say something today great about graphs that you didn't know or don't understand, you can always come back and watch it again. We are going to kick off the measurement unit when you come back to class tomorrow. And this is where math and chemistry overlap. And all of a sudden you're like, whoa, I thought we were in science class. And so we always call math mental abuse to humans. But we are going to guide you through this and help you be more confident about this. And I don't think you're going to have that many issues. And we're always here to help you if you do. I chose the background of this display today just for Miss Diaz because her favorite color is purple. Can ya tell? So when we are making a graph, if you look over here on the left side, we gave you some components to make a good graph. If you were just looking at this big grid and it just had some dots and some lines and stuff on it, you would have no idea what that graph was trying to communicate to you without words. So you definitely need some words on your graph. So if you're given an XY chart like this, or if you're given a table of values for something such as density, you could begin to create a good graph. So right now, if we don't know what X and Y are, we would literally just label our bottom as X and our side as Y. We don't tend to do that in science. We usually know what we're measuring. So for today, we're going to say that the X is the volume and the Y is the mass. So on top of our little T chart there, I've put volume and mass because to a chemist that makes a lot more sense than X and Y. So if we are labeling or graphing volume and mass, hopefully you remember from middle school that density is equal to mass over volume. So we are doing a mass to volume comparison, and so we need to label our axes just this way. So over on our graph, I am going to label my independent. If you look over here, your independent variable is always on the x-axis. Your teachers have probably said for years that the X stands alone, which means that it doesn't need the Y to exist. It doesn't depend on anyone else. So in this case, our X is our volume. So we're going to label it volume. We also need to make sure that there are units on all of our dimensions. So let's say we're measuring today in milliliters. You always want to include that so the person reading your graph knows what they're looking at. So our y-axis over here is going to be our mass measured in grams. So if we know that we're building a graph comparing mass to volume, what do you suppose a good title for our graph could be? Well, if you looked down here, we said that density was mass over volume. So a good title for our graph could very well be a density graph. You could get more detailed. You could say the density of what? So if we were doing density of water, we could say this is a density of water graph. And so you want to be as specific as possible, but don't get so wordy that people get confused as to what you're trying to tell them. Now we need to make sure that our boxes are numbered and we have evenly spaced our numbers at good intervals and really stretched out our graph to include as many numbers as possible. If I look at my volume versus mass chart up here, I kind of just take a look at all of my values and say, what's the highest number that I see? Well, on the y-axis, the highest number I see is 18. So I need to try to stretch this and use as much of the graph as possible and really make my graph nice. And over here, my highest number is 20. So I looked down here on the bottom and I counted my boxes, and I have about 27 boxes going in each direction. Rather than making this uber complicated, I said I have enough boxes that every one line can count as one unit. And so I just made little hash marks here every 5 lines. We don't want to label every box. And so we're going to come back and just label every few and say this is box 5, 10, 15, and 20. And we're going to do the same thing on the y-axis, 5, 10, 15, and 20. So at least spreads out our graph. So any white space we have might be a little bit over here, but again, just try to stretch it as much as you can up into that top right corner. We don't want your points to go off of the graph, but we don't want to, the majority of your graph to be empty, if that makes sense. If we were graphing 2 sets of data, we would want to make sure to have a key somewhere telling the reader which line represented which set of data. In this instance, I only gave you 1 t-chart, but in the lab that you're going to do tomorrow, you're going to be graphing 2 sets of data, so you need to have a little color-coded key somewhere that says this is the density of water, this is the density of oil, something like that to let us know what we're looking at. So now we get to the point where we are ready to plot our data. So I just went down my volume and mass t-chart down here at the bottom, and I just plotted my points. So if you looked at your points, it is so tempting to want to connect the dots. But as scientists, really, we're not trying to connect the dots. We took this experimental data. It should be a smooth line, and we probably messed up in the lab a little. So our line looks a little zigzagged. So what we're going to do instead is create something called the line of best fit. So what I did here is I took a ruler and I drew a line that got me close to most of the points, but doesn't necessarily go through all of them. And that is totally fine. In theory, it doesn't have to go through any of them, but it just has to represent an average of all of your data. And so you'll notice that he was way out there. This point really would have made my line zigzagged. So I kind of ignored him, wanted to keep that line as straight as possible. It looks like I went through the top of this point, maybe the top of this point, went right above this point, and didn't really get close to him. But this line represents an average of my data. Now we're going to look at this word right here. It's called interpolate. Inter means inside. We plotted 4 points, but our line represents many, 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 an infinite number of points onto infinity, because this line keeps going and never ends. And so this word interpolate means I want to know what this line represents, and here's the key word, inside of the points. So go with me here. If I was looking at a point anywhere along this portion of the line, this would be considered interpolation. The reason this is considered interpolation is because I am looking at points in between the dots that I plotted on my graph. So anything in that yellow zone on the red line is considered interpolation. So if I wanted to know about this point here, I'm interpolating. This point here, I'm interpolating. This point here, I am interpolating. However, if I want to know about a point outside of my plotted points, extra means in addition to, so if this was my last point right about here, this area that extends up past that point would be extrapolation. And this area below my first point would also be extrapolation. So let's look at this. If I highlight it here, anything in this green zone outside of my plotted points is considered extrapolation. It's extra. It's outside of my points. So this is really convenient to a scientist because all they have to do is collect a reasonable amount of data, extend their line, and they have an infinite amount of data points that they can infer and extrapolate or interpolate. So they can get a whole lot of data from just a few points. Now that I have a best fit line, I can calculate slope. We know you already know how to do this, but we're just presenting it in a little bit different of way and showing you how it relates to our class in chemistry. So you remember from Algebra 1 that slope is the change in y over the change in x, or we call it rise over run. Well, in our case today, we are talking about it in a density standpoint. So our rise is our mass right over here, and our run is our volume. So for us, our slope could really be mass over volume. And if you remember back to our previous slide, we said density was equal to mass over volume. So effectively, we could say that density was our slope. So now that we have our best fit line, I don't care about the little blue dots anymore. So notice I took those off of my graph. I can go to any point on the line. Let's just choose one right here. I can go to any point on this line and I can look and find out what my rise over my run is, and I can calculate slope. So watch this. I'm going to come all the way over here and notice that my mass was 14 grams. That was my rise. And then I'm going to go straight down to my x-axis. And I hit about 17. That's 17 milliliters. Your points might not always be exactly on a line, and then you'd have to estimate like 14.2, 17.8. We want you to measure and record things like a super scientist. And then we'd put that in a calculator, and we'd find out that the density, or the mass over volume, the slope, was 0.82, and in science, we always include our letters on our answer, grams over milliliters. And so because this is our slope, and we said that our slope was our density of our substance must be something really close to 0.82. So slope is used in all sorts of ways in science and in math. This is just one of the ones you're going to see. Hopefully this helps you a lot in today's activity, and we will see you soon. Thanks, guys.